Present.
Counsel Baring.
Here.
Counsel Fritz. Counsel Graw.
Here.
Counsel McGinty.
Here.
Counsel Reed.
Here.
And Counsel Watson.
Here.
Thank you. Pledge allegiance.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Okay, thank you. We'll move down to citizens' discussion of items not on the agenda. And before I get to that, I'd like to suggest that there may be some people here who want to say something in regard to the Lighthouse Keeper's House. And I would like to, rather than take that at this point, attach that to item 47, which is the one that establishes or may establish a Historic Preservation Study Committee. So with that said, are there any other citizens here with other issues that they would like to present that are not on the agenda? We'll do that, okay, under presentations. Let me move on to presentations. We have two presentations to do, which gives me great pleasure. Let me give one first. Okay, Wood, Nancy Hawes, and Jim Russell, please come forward.
Hi.
Look right up here, and there's the camera. Look right up there and smile. So I want to just congratulate both these people and thank them. They are here representing the South Portland and Cape Elizabeth Rotary Club, which was founded in 1961. And I want to read some of the things that the club has done under your administrations, and we wish to thank you for that. First of all, in earlier years, this group provided the seed money for the construction of the picnic shelter and an exercise course at Fort Williams Park. The club has also provided the flagpole at the park and recently was responsible for the new landscaping at the Joan Benoit sculpture. The Fort Williams model at the museum at Portland Headlight had an expense of over $15,000, which was fully funded by this club. Under the leadership of past President Jim Russell and current President Nancy Hawes, the Rotary Club has truly made a difference in Cape Elizabeth. Since July 1st, 97 and through to June 30th, 99, the club committed $12,000 to the new stone wall that now surrounds the pond at Fort Williams. This past spring, the club donated the materials and painted the long garages behind Officers Row and recently gave a $500 donation to the Fort Williams Centennial Celebration. Rotary members recently agreed to provide the materials and to build bleachers at the new Little League field at Lions Field. In addition, over the 2 years that Jim and Nancy have been leading the club, Rotary has provided $4,000 in scholarships to graduating seniors at Cape Elizabeth High School, is sponsoring an exchange student from Siberia at the high school, is providing leadership training through the Rotary Youth Leadership Awards program, and continues to help send students to Boys and Girls State. The club also sponsored 3 Cape Elizabeth residents to participate in an exchange program that took them to Finland. The club also supports many programs in South Portland, a soup kitchen in Portland, and 10% of all that they earn is given for humanitarian programs throughout the world. During Jim Russell and Nancy Hawes' terms as president of the Rotary Club, the group is giving over $25,000 in direct support to Cape Elizabeth and an equal amount to programs in South Portland and throughout the world. Tonight, on behalf of the town of Cape Elizabeth, I am pleased to thank the South Portland Cape Elizabeth Rotary Club for all of their assistance to our community, and would like to present Nancy and Jim with plaques recognizing their leadership. Thank you very much. Thank you. Thank you. I'll take that right out and let everyone see it. And thank you. Did I get the right one?
No, that's all right. All right.
In that case,
yeah, the 50-50 try.
There, all right.
All right.
Jim, thank you, and thank you very much. Appreciate it very much.
Just remember to buy your sister's friends.
Okay. Oh,
Okay, we have another presentation tonight, and I believe there are three people here. Joan, would you like to come up and introduce your two compatriots as well, please?
Hello.
Thank you very much.
Hi, Dave.
Welcome.
Dave, hi, Dave. Step right up. Make sure the camera can see you.
With me this evening, we have Lee Bagley, who's representing People's Heritage Bank as Vice President of Marketing, and Dave Weatherby, who is the President of the People's Beach to Beacon 10K Board. And we're basically here tonight to express our appreciation to the town of Cape Elizabeth for bending over backwards to accommodate our every need and to make the inaugural event such a fine affair. We've had accolades from around the world, and we're delighted that the town has embraced this event and wants to continue running it with us in the years to come. And I remember being here a year and a half ago, and I was very nervous, and I really didn't know what to expect, and I know you didn't know what to expect, but I really don't think we could have asked for a better community to have staged this event. And I hope you'll be with us for the roads and years ahead. Thank you very much. And what we have tonight is a framed poster of the event with all the invited athlete signatures from around the world. And it says, People's Beach to Beacon 10K applauds the warm and generous welcome from the town of Cape Elizabeth. May we continue to shine the light for kids for years to come. Thank you all very much.
Thank you very much.
Joan, let me say thank you very much. And also, Lee, thank you to Peoples for sponsoring it. Joan, everyone knows, did a magnificent job in really getting this started and moving it together, and we appreciate that. Thank you very much.
Well, thank you.
Okay, I think that completes our presentations. We'll go on to councilors' reports and correspondence. Are there any councilors with reports or correspondence? Well, okay. That moves us along then. We'll go to the town manager's report. Mike.
To follow the council's lead, I'll also pass this evening.
Well, okay. In order to upstage everyone, here's Debbie.
I'll be brief. Thank you. Just a reminder to the residents that nomination papers for the Portland Water District trustee, which is a five-year term, and the unexpired town council seat, those papers are now available in my office. Anyone that would like to apply, please come and see me or give me a call. The deadline is Monday, September 21st, which is a week from this evening, at 5 o'clock p.m. Thank you.
Thank you. Move to referring to the minutes of the previous meeting. Would anyone care to make changes or make a motion?
Yes.
Councilor Berry.
Mr. Chairman, just a minor point here on the minutes of the August 10th meeting. On the second page, it said, I reported that two members of the newly formed Fry Island the town have been elected to serve on the Cumberland County Budget Advisory Committee. That's not accurate. Chris Bowering was the only one who was appointed. The Fry Island gentleman did attend the meeting. But to be accurate, Chris Bowering was the one who was elected to the County Budget Advisory Committee meeting, and he and I will serve from our district.
Thank you. Are there any other changes? Would anyone care to move the, yes, Councilor McGinney?
I move approval of the minutes from meeting number 3, number 4, and number 5 of 98-99 year.
Second.
Seconded by Councilor Berry. Any discussion? Hearing none, all those in favor, please raise your hand. Any against? It passes unanimously. Thank you very much. Moving us to item 42, acceptance of the resignation of the council chairman effective September 30th, 98, and election of a replacement council chairman, replacement member of MMA, legislative policy committee, and the filling of any other resulting vacancies. The chair takes this opportunity to apologize to all of the people in Cape Elizabeth. I am taking a job in New Hampshire, and accordingly am resigning effective the end of the month. And I apologize, I had not intended to be leaving in the middle of my term. And the only thing that makes me feel a little better is that there are able people here who will continue to do a good job in my absence. With that said, would anyone care to make a motion? Councilor Berry.
Mr. Chairman, I would move that the council chairman, effective September 30th, upon your resignation, be Councilor Joseph Graff, and that we have a replacement member of the MMA, the Maine Municipal Association, Legislative Policy Committee, and I move for Councilor Ruth Watson to fill that. Is there another one?
Finance.
Yeah, would you care to also mention the Finance Committee?
Yes, I'd like to move that Councilor Rosemary Reed be elected as the chairman of the Finance Committee.
Great, thank you.
And those three nominations are part of one motion.
Is there a second?
Second.
Seconded by Councilor Watson. Any discussion? Hearing none, all those in favor?
Aye.
Are there any against? It passes unanimously. Thank you very much.
Mr. Chairman, before we continue, perhaps we could go to the podium.
Oh, well, thank you very much.
Bill, I'm sorely disappointed that you're leaving us, not just because you've been a wonderful chair of the town council, but because you've been a great citizen of Cape Elizabeth for a number of years. We have all benefited from your stay here in Cape Elizabeth. We've all benefited from your willingness to serve in various positions, and you will be sorely missed. In appreciation of your service to the town, here is a plaque which has your name as Town Council Chairperson 1998.
Thank you.
I appreciate your service. I say that on behalf of the Town Council and everyone in the town.
Well, thank you.
Best wishes, Bill. Best wishes.
Very much to you, Joe. Other councilors, thank you very much. I've enjoyed serving, and it's been a lot of fun and very nice. Thank you.
Mr. Chairman, just a point of order. I'm not sure whether I included in my motion vocalizing the acceptance of your resignation as of September 30th, but I intended that to be part of the motion.
I took that to be included.
Yeah.
As through the minutes.
Yes.
Yes.
Thank you. Right. Okay, moving to item 43. This is a very interesting one. It's acceptance of a $1,000 grant award from Walmart Foundation in honor of Rosemary Reed. And I should say that Walmart apparently has a program whereby they recognize people in local government across the country, and they have a process by which they identify people who have, and let me read specifically because I think this is a very laudatory line, the ability to envision great things for their community and their ability to translate that vision into action makes them deserving of our highest honor. And they have picked Rosemary for the work that she's done with the bottle program and the return program there. Rosemary, congratulations. Now, I'm assuming it will be the council's plan to designate this money in a way that will be constructive for the return program. And I assume that all of us may play some role in that. Although, Rosemary, I'm sure we're going to look to you for some suggestions.
Thank you.
And thank you for your good work.
Thank you. May I just say a comment to the general public? Part of the reason the program was a success was because people from town, week after week, month after month, for almost 6 years now, have contributed their returnable bottles, cans, plastic water jugs, etc., to the youth of Cape Elizabeth. And I'm pleased to announce that so far, the youth of Cape Elizabeth have benefited by the generosity of the townspeople to the extent of more than $100,000. So it's quite a milestone, and thank you very much.
Yeah. I believe a formal vote of acceptance of the $1,000 is required. Would anyone care to move that we do that? Councilor
Kennedy.
Second.
Second.
I could have had that one, John.
Any further discussion on accepting the money?
No?
Okay. All those in favor? Any against?
It passes unanimously. Again, thank you, Rosemary.
Okay, we'll now move to the addressing ordinance, and I believe at this time we call open a public hearing in case there are people who wish to discuss, ask questions, or other, make other comments. Are there any people here who would like to comment on that? I hear none. Are there any councilors who would like to make any comments on it prior to us closing the public hearing? I see none. All right, we'll close the public hearing. That was very quick. And we'll move to item 44, which is action to approve proposed addressing ordinance. Would anyone care to say anything? I know at least one or two people here have spent some time on this. John?
I'd just like to say that so people understand what the purpose of this is essentially mandated by state law with the 911 enhanced system coming online, that towns, communities, cities they must address issues and try to mitigate the possibility of emergency services being dispatched to the wrong location for similar sounding roads or streets, and that every property in fact have an address. Not in this town so much, but when you get out in more rural Maine, you have a lot of fire lanes, etc. And there's a requirement for those communities to actually name and number the houses. There will be, I think, some disruption in this town. We do have some streets that sound alike, but the purpose, in the purpose of the ordinance, it mandates that the addressing committee will mitigate that disruption, you know, to the extent that's possible. So there's the possibility of some disruption, and the names of the new roads or the numbering system will have to be brought, particularly the names of the roads will have to be brought back to the council for approval. So citizens will have additional input should their particular address be impacted. But again, we're going to try to mitigate that the best we can.
Thank you for explaining that. Other comments? Discussion? Yes, Councilor Berry.
Just one incident that demonstrates that need, I think. There's a Pleasant and a Pheasant in the town of Cape Elizabeth and many other similar names. And I spoke with a tow truck operator one night who went out one night on a call, and he thought it was Pleasant, and he went to Pheasant, and he started opening up this man's car, and the man came out and said, "What are you doing in my car? It's in the wrong street." That's only one example. The mail is another problem to deal with, so that I think this is an excellent idea to straighten out the identity of these various streets. Thank you.
Good, thank you. Other comments?
I just had a quick one. Just a reminder that at some point in the future, you'll also have some amendments to the subdivision ordinance coming by that address some of the issues for new streets to be named. Those have already been to the planning board, and they'll be coming back to the council when you have other amendments to the subdivision ordinance and zoning ordinance, which we expect you to have before you in the next month or two.
Okay, are we ready to consider action to take in regard to the addressing ordinance? Councilor Reed.
Mr. Chairman, I move that we accept the addressing ordinance and adopt.
I second. Thank you. Seconded by Councilor Berry. Any further discussion? Hearing none, would we care to vote? All in favor? Any against? Thank you very much. Thank you to those of you that did a lot of work on this. We move to item 45, consideration of town council goals for 98-99. Quick question, does consideration call for a vote or simply communication? I assume a vote? Okay, then let me, unless anybody wants to go over these, so I'll take a moment or two and just review some of the goals that the council has established, because I think they're important. These represent the things which we intend to spend time on next year. It will be an allocation of prioritization for time, and some of these things will receive a lot of effort. Some may be assigned individually to counselors who will spend time on it because they have either interest or perhaps expertise in the area. So there will be different amounts of time and collective energy spent on them. But I do want to spend just a second and review some because it's very important. And I would encourage anyone who would like to add comments to speak up. Priority, and this is the priority goal number one, reduce the burden of the property tax. The property tax is a burden for all of Cape Elizabeth's property owners and indirectly for its renters. It is the goal of the town council to reduce the burden of the property tax through a number of means. They include, the town council will aggressively review the annual budget and will prioritize services and spending. The council will direct town staff to extensively promote the use of the state circuit breaker and homestead exemption programs so that everyone in the town gains the full benefit from those. The town council will receive and act upon a report from the Fort Williams Advisory Commission relating to sharing the burden of the costs of the fort with its users. The town will review other user fee options to determine that certain services are meeting their costs. The town will also look at support groups such as football boosters and friends of the library to assist with programs and facilities. The council will have a long-term approach to spending issues through continuing annual updates of the five-year capital improvement program. The council will meet with the school board to enhance a collective understanding of short and long-term issues affecting school spending. The town will review all of its communication methods, including telephone systems, cellular services, two-way radios, pages, and internet services in order to restrain costs. The town will look for savings in debt service costs through refinancing earlier bonds and efficient bonding of other needs. Those were all under the heading of addressing the burden of the property tax. Priority number two, implement the town's Facilities 2000 initiative, including pool improvements. For over 10 years, the town has been aware of severe overcrowding of our public safety facilities, insufficient space for athletic fields, and the loss of open space to development pressures. In 1998, the town purchased the former Levitt property in order to address these issues. A citizen committee has also identified major work that needs to be done on the Donald Richards Pool if Cape Elizabeth is to continue to have a community swimming pool. The town council will work in council year 98-99 to move forward the Facilities 2000 initiative as follows. The town council will approve a master plan for the former Levitt property in 1998. Final design will commence in 98 on a new public works garage, two athletic fields, and trail work on the Levitt property. The town council will approve a master plan in early 99 for the conversion of the current public works garage into a fire station and the current engine 2 station into an expanded police facility. The town council will work on the public works and public safety projects with an objective to complete ball fields, trails, and the public works facility no later than December 1999, and the public safety facilities by December of 2000. Citizens will vote in November 98 on the proposed updating of the community swimming pool. Pending a favorable vote, construction will begin in 99 or as soon as pool scheduling permits. Those were the two primary goals. I will now list quickly additional town council goals. These are not in priority order anymore and somewhat random, but nevertheless, I think all constructive. The town will seek to increase citizen participation through effective and coordinated use of the web page and the cable television access channel. The cable channel will include more school use and cable casting of the Zoning Board of Appeals. The town council will continue to recognize citizen volunteers and employees for their service to the community. The town will inventory its open space and greenbelt system and will prepare a report on stewardship of these assets. The town council will act upon a report recommending protective measures for the town farm. The town center sidewalk and drainage improvement program will be under construction during this council year. The town will seek a contract with the Public Works bargaining unit that is fair to employees and that is reasonable to taxpayers. The town will continue to work with community services and private daycare providers to assess the need for daycare services in Cape Elizabeth. The town council will continue to promote voluntary contributions to town trust funds and make the Thomas Jordan Trust work more effectively for its beneficiaries. The town council will encourage the use of forums to discuss issues involving small business in the community. A study will be undertaken to see if the Route 77 / Scott Dyer Road / Shore Road intersection can be made safer for pedestrians. The town council will receive a report on the capacity of the Southern Cape Elizabeth treatment plant and on its use of the South Portland treatment plant. The town council will form a committee to review policies and practices relating to the preservation of historic properties. The town council will work with the staff in developing a strategic plan for the Cape Elizabeth Rescue Unit. The town council will determine the future disposition of the former service station lot next to the town hall. The town will review the need for a center for the youth and the elderly of the community and will evaluate the use of the community center. The town council will continue efforts leading to enhanced 911 implementation, including reviewing street names and numbering, as we've done tonight. The town will review issues relating to access to Great Pond near Fenway Road. The town council will review issues on how youth can become more knowledgeable on the workings of town government and the town council in particular. The town will better communicate tax assessment, planning, and code enforcement issues and practices. The town will work with the zoning board to assess patents in the approvals and denials of variance requests. Would anyone care to add anything that I may have missed? Okay, thank you. That's an attempt to outline for all of you the many things and the varied things that we will be working on next year, and understand, please, that the priorities were the first two, obviously, because when it comes, push comes to shove, those are the two that will get the most attention. Okay, are we looking for some sort of a vote? Councilor Berry.
I would make a motion that the goals, as you have just read them, be accepted as a planning guide for the town council for the coming year.
Thank you. Is there a second?
Second.
Yes, thank you. Okay, it's moved and seconded. Any further discussion? Hearing none, all those in favor? Are there any against? Those who are not, it passes unanimously. Thank you very much. Item 46, consideration of approval of state / local agreement for town center sidewalk and drainage project. Mike, are you going to address that?
Yes.
That's 45.
I did?
45. You said 46.
I'm working off the wrong piece of paper. Okay, I'm sorry, go ahead.
This is probably about the 10th time that this has been before the council in one form or another, in either a workshop or at a council meeting. This merely establishes the formal relationship with state government for the construction of the town center sidewalk and drainage project. It does not commit you to the exact design. You'll have an opportunity on Wednesday evening, on the 28th, I get confused, all the different committees, on the 28th to look at the plans again. Maureen O'Meara and Steve Harding, both of whom are here this evening, the town planner and the town engineer respectively, have met with all the different neighbors and have worked out a number of issues with them. The project seems to be moving along very well, and I would encourage you to authorize this document to be signed so that we can make sure that we get our reimbursement at the appropriate period. And both Steve and Maureen are here, should you have any detailed questions on this.
Yes, Councilor Reed.
I have a question, but it's for the town manager. Is this something that the state has not required us to do before, but might be asking us to do, because in the past there have been so many projects that were started and not completed?
Not at all. No, this is routine, and every project that we've ever done, federal, state for transportation, has had one of these agreements at the time that it was pretty clear that it would be moving forward in some form.
Thank you.
Other questions? Yes, Councilor McGinn.
I guess, well, just it's the same question, I guess. I want a clarification, maybe a better clarification. why did this come up for this particular project? I mean, it makes it look like it's something special for them to write a letter and say, we don't agree, we want an easement for the economic life of the project. Is that, if it's normally in every contract, why wasn't it, or?
That's a separate issue, Councilor McGinty. The agreement is necessary for every project. In this particular instance, there is a slight wrinkle in that a portion of the sidewalk for this is actually going to be on what they consider to be school property or town property, rather than in the right-of-way for the road. So they've asked, and we've gone back and forth three or four times on this, for a dedication of that space where the sidewalk is actually on town property instead of in the right-of-way, that be dedicated for the economic life of the project. And they'll be sending an agreement, and then that specific language of that agreement will again come before the council before we sign that. This merely is an indication in that instance that you authorize me to sign the agreement for the project itself, and there'll be a separate agreement for the economic life provision.
Okay.
This is one of these projects that will be before you probably 20 times before it's done.
Already has been.
Councilor Reed.
Yes, Mr. Chairman, I move that we authorize the town manager to sign the agreement and that the town manager be authorized to sign the agreement that provides that the land required along the school property for the sidewalk be dedicated as a sidewalk area for the economic life of this project.
Thank you. Is there a second?
Second.
Seconded by Councilor Watson. Further discussion? Hearing none. All those in favor, please raise your hand. Any against? It passes unanimously. Thank you very much. Okay, moving on to item 46. This is consideration of establishment of Historic Preservation Study Committee. At this time, I'd like to commit those people who may wish to discuss a related subject to this, not the subject, as if this were a discussion of citizens' discussion of items not on the agenda. Councilor Goff?
Before we have that discussion, though, I would certainly like it presented to the public what it is that is the item here.
Oh,
if
okay.
We could just have an introduction of this item, then I would have no problem at all with that procedure.
Why don't you, if you got it, go ahead, please.
Well, I think I'd like the town manager. If
oh, all right.
Do that if you would.
He will in a moment.
Thank you, Mr. Graf. I appreciate you asking me to do that. The town council earlier looked at this charge at a workshop that was prepared by the town planner. And what it provides is that because of some recent issues involving applications for demolition permits, including one for a town project, that there's been some attention focused on historic preservation regulation. You would create a committee under this proposed motion to study the status of historic preservation in Cape Elizabeth and to report its findings. The committee would consist of seven persons, including two council members, and also representatives of the Planning Board, Zoning Board, and the Cape Historic Preservation Society. You would also appoint two citizens, one of whom would be an owner of a property on the historic structures list to the committee. You'd use your appointments committee process for that. The committee charge would be to review the current town historic preservation regulations and historic structures list, to aggressively solicit public opinion regarding the extent of historic preservation and regulation desired by residents using a variety of techniques, to explore a variety of historic preservation options, including the elements of a historic preservation ordinance, to review the historic structures list for completeness and possible priority status for higher priority historic structures, and to provide a report to the town council no later than June 30, 1999, including only recommendations which have broad public support.
Okay.
I appreciate that, Mr. Chairman. And now I have no problem with anyone speaking as long as we are clearly focused on the fact that this is the matter before the town council at this time.
Yes, I understand that, but I believe there may be people who wish to speak, and we're going to move in a slightly irregular way to permit that at this time. Are those people here? And if yes, come on up. Please obviously step to the microphone, indicate who you are, and please try to be as succinct as possible.
I will do so. Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. My name is Tom Egan. I live at 41 Hannaford Cove Road.
been a resident there since, with a brief stay in New York City, since 1980. I am a member of a group of citizens who have elected to call themselves the Friends of Two Lights. Essentially, we are a group of neighbors down in the Two Lights, Hanaford Cove area, who have a very legitimate, we believe, concern about the impending partial demolition and significant alteration of the lighthouse at Two Lights. I won't go into the history of the issue because there has been a public hearing on the matter before you. Recently, you held a workshop about a week and a half ago, and further Chairman Beyer and some historic preservation representatives attended a meeting with Mr. Caracos, the owner, last Friday. So the history is before you already, so I won't repeat that. After the workshop last week, or 10 days ago, we expressed among ourselves a very significant concern that the town was not taking what we felt was definitive action because it either didn't think it could take action legally or because it felt that there was insufficient citizen support to take action. Now, we're talking about specifically preventing the owner of the Keeper's House at Two Lights from his plans to partially demolish it and to alter it significantly. So we set out in a three-tiered strategy approximately 10 days ago, bearing in mind that the extended hiatus, if you will, on activity is due to end at the end of September. This three-stage strategy includes, number one, the retention of attorneys to give to you an opinion which addresses the concern that you have. Can we do anything? Does the town of Cape Elizabeth have any authority to prevent the partial demolition or significant alteration of the Keeper's House at Two Lights? We retained the law firm of Murray, Plum & Murray, which gave us an opinion, a copy of which we have provided to as many of you as we could get a hold of. I sent it to the town manager last week. That opinion specifically states, the town has legal authority to enact a moratorium on the issuance of permits for the demolition or alteration of historic structures, including the Keeper's House at Two Lights, and to enact an historic preservation ordinance that would be applicable retroactively to attempts to modify historic structures, again, including the Keeper's House at Two Lights. The opinion also goes on to state, to address your concern about the town being sued by the owner for taking legislative action to prevent him from moving ahead with his plans. And the attorneys stated quite succinctly and clearly that the town indeed might be sued by Mr. Caracos, but in the opinion of counsel, the likelihood of his succeeding on the merits was remote. So that is where we think that we've addressed your concern about A, whether you have the authority, and B, whether or not if you were to take action you would get sued. And both those questions are A, you have the authority, and B, you might get sued, but the town would succeed on the merits in that case. The second leg of our strategy addressed citizen support for your action. We know that there has been an issue in town here in connection with the plans that preservation groups or persons concerned about preserving the lighthouse at Two Lights were trampling upon the private property rights of Mr. Caracos. And that is indeed an issue which deserves consideration and debate. That debate can be carried out in this forum over a period of time as you have set forth here in your plans to create a commission. But in the meantime, the property is indeed at risk at the end of the month. So in order to support your action, we set out to petition the town, ask the town citizens to subscribe to a petition which states as follows. Citizen petition to the town of Cape Elizabeth, Maine, for a moratorium and for an emergency historic preservation ordinance. Now, all of the petitions that we've taken make these significant provisions. The undersigned petition, the Town Council of Cape Elizabeth, for a moratorium on demolition or alteration of historic structures and for an emergency historic preservation ordinance to protect and preserve historic places. Structures and places to which the moratorium applies should include Portland Headlight at Fort Williams, Spurwink Church, and the Keeper's House at Two Lights. We'd like to present to you at this time the petitions which we've gathered in just over 4 days at two sites, Pond Cove and one day at the dump. John Rich, who's the keeper of the archives in our group, has the petitions. And I'll ask Hillary and Florence Braff, who work with us on the petitions, to show you graphically what these petitions say.
There were 724 people who signed this. 612 of them, I think Elizabeth Redford, other people came in, wanted to sign.
Thank you.
Now we've retained a copy of the petitions, actually two copies. You will find that there are approximately 200 petitions which incorporated the name of a property which was placed in there in error. And when it came to our attention, at the end of the first day of petitioning that we had incorporated this property in the petition, we immediately contacted the owner of the property and did not go forward petitioning using that form. We contacted attorneys to ask them what we could do with those petitions, and they indicated that obviously it would be inappropriate to change or amend them, but that indeed there were 200 citizens approximately who had spoken out on the issue, so we've incorporated those in your packet. And any additional information about that the town council would like to address, we can respond to. The third thing that, by the way, this process, I want to say, was very enlightening for me personally. I expected that there would be a great deal of debate as people approached us about the petition. I anticipated that there might be some heated conversation. But while my wife Hillary and I were at the dump on Saturday, it went so well. Everyone was respectful. The fellow who runs the dump was very congenial and told us where to go, and we stayed in that location. We spent a lot of time explaining our position. We had graphic representations of what we thought the issues were. And I think I speak for everyone in this group who took the petitions to say that, A, we appreciate the opportunity to participate in the process here in Cape Elizabeth. And secondly, the citizens treated us with great respect. And finally, we hope that their statements to you will bear the weight that we think it deserves. Now thank you very much. The third effort which we undertook was to try to bring some sense, some of aesthetic criticism to what is being said about Mr. Crocco's plans, namely that the plans do not address standards that apply to historic and landmark places. And in order to do that, we contacted Mr. Shuttleworth at the Maine Commission on Historic Preservation, and we asked him if he would hold forth to the commission on his view of the plans and help the council and the citizens understand what the stakes are and what could be done, if anything, to accommodate Mr. Caracco's plans and the needs of the historic preservation movement, if you will. Mr. Shuttleworth refused our request to make known the position of the commission. Instead, he asked
he stated that it would be necessary for the chairman, Mr. Beyer, or for the town council to specifically ask him to hold forth on his position as to the plans as they relate to historic preservation. So in order for the town council to address this question before the end of the month, we think that it's imperative that you ask Mr. Shuttleworth what he feels or what the commission feels are the significant points at risk, and what their conclusions are with respect to whether the plans meet any historic preservation standards. Lastly, and most important, in keeping with the statements of the petitioners, the desires of the petitioners, and in furtherance in furtherance of our group's goal, we are asking you tonight to suspend your rules and to take up for consideration an emergency ordinance in the form of a moratorium on the issuance of building or demolition permits with respect to historic landmarks. We have drafted a very short statement of moratorium. It's essentially just a page long. We believe that it meets the legal requirements. I'm not certain how Robert's rules applies to our request for suspension of the rules, but I would like the opportunity to present to the council this proposed moratorium so that if you elect to do so, and we hope you will, you may take moratorium action on this immediately and prevent the impending partial demolition and significant alteration of the lighthouse at Two Lights before it's too late.
Before we do that, have that discussion, Mr. Egan, are there other people that we're going to present at this point in time? Yes, sir. Please come up.
While Mr. Caracas is coming forward, may I ask Mr. Egan a question?
Oh, yeah, absolutely. I'm sorry. Go ahead.
Mr. Egan, you said, and thank you for disclosing, that there are signatures, approximately 200 signatures affixed to a petition language, body of language, that is not accurate?
Well, there is a building which we listed, which we thought was a structure in Fort Williams, but which turned out not to be a structure in Fort Williams.
And that would be a private residence?
That is a private residence, which is not a national landmark or historic place as listed by the Maine Commission on Historic Preservation. And that is why, when it came to our attention, we no longer used that form. However, I want to note that all of the signatures address the moratorium and a request for an emergency historic preservation ordinance for the Two Lights Keeper's House.
Thank you.
Yes, Councilor Watts.
Mr. Egan, one question. I understand about a week ago thereabouts that Mr. Caracas had an informational meeting at his home at which Greater Portland Landmarks, the Cape Elizabeth Historical Society, the Maine Historic Preservation Commission, and Bill Beyer was there.
Right.
Could you please tell me who represented the Friends of Two Lights at that meeting?
The Friends of Two Lights, after meeting to discuss the issue, elected not to attend because two of our members had attended small and personal discussions with Mr. Caracas at his house to review the plans that Mr. Caracas had prepared. So we felt that since two individuals had gone up and reported to us on each occasion their views, we elected not to burden that meeting, if you will, with our presence.
That was a meeting, I believe, that the town council had requested all the people who were interested to be at that meeting. So I guess I have some concerns. I think that, according to what I have heard about that meeting, is Mr. Caracas had presented some scales and some plans that showed his representation as it would meet the standards of the Department of the Interior, as well as his plans that he has put forth to date, as well as the existing structure. I think it might have been helpful.
Well, we've had
two subsequent conversations with Mr. Caracos and understood that he had asked his architect to prepare a plan which would show his concept as if it were to address the standards. But he also stated that his plans, he believes, that we have seen, are the plans indeed that he plans to go ahead with. So just to summarize, that meeting we felt would be superfluous because we had already had two individuals in private meetings, or two or three individuals in private meetings, going up to see the same plans that he was showing at the time, except for that, that
most
recent.
There was a difference. Right. He did have the Department of the Interior Standard plans there to be reviewed at that meeting.
But those are not the plans that he's going to use.
Are there other councilors with questions before Mr. Egan finishes?
Okay, thank you, Mr. Egan.
Thank you very much.
Yes, Mr. Parker, please also state who you are, where you're from, and also.
My name is also Bill Caracos, and I am resident of Cape Elizabeth and have been for in excess of 30 years. I am the father of the owner of the residence at Two Lights. And I was very, very upset when I learned only late this afternoon that the council would be entertaining a motion that was unscheduled on their agenda regarding this subject. And I'd like to step back about a month ago, and I'm going to be repeating some of the things that have been said here by the council members, that a public meeting was arranged here in the town hall, and it was attended by several citizens of the community. This room was filled to capacity, and the Friends of Two Lights, as they have become known, got up and made a presentation, as did my son that night, as did many of the citizens that evening. And the some substance of that entire meeting that night, the council unanimously voted to accept a voluntary 45-day moratorium, during which time members of the council, neighbors, people that are friends of Two Lights, and any other citizen were welcome to visit his home, to review the plans, to answer questions. Following this public meeting, the town council held a workshop, and there was considerable discussion as to what the town council could or could not do. After considerable discussion, again, it was unanimously agreed that identified persons would be invited to Bill's home, and Chairwoman Watson listed this group of individuals, and that it was a question of who was going to coordinate all this. Mr. McDonald agreed that he would do the coordinating. And the whole purpose of this was to have some knowledgeable people, including Mr. Shuttlesworth, come to Bill's home to review the plans that he's going to use, not some perceived plans, but to review the plans that he's going to use, to look at the property, to compare it to the original home that was up there before it was altered in the late 70s to what it is today, and even pictures that had been published. People have been ashamed to publish what is there today, but rather they've gone back and, to use the word loosely, plagiarized previous photos that just don't exist anymore. But in any event, this meeting was arranged. and the invitees came. Mr. McDonald chose not to come. And it wasn't the purpose of this meeting was not to inform Mr. McDonald or anybody on the Friends of Two Lights Committee. The whole purpose of this meeting was to have the experts go there. And hopefully other people would have attended that meeting like Chairman Byard decided to do, and to make certain that questions were of substance, that there weren't anything, any answers or responses to the invitees that might not be totally true, and also, more importantly, to hear any objections that any of the invitees might have. Now, since this public meeting that we had about a month ago, several neighbors, several people have visited Bill's home. He was on vacation all of August, and he spent a good part of it on this very issue. Several people have taken it upon themselves to write him letters. Many people have supported what he is doing. And yes, we talked about the rights of individuals to do things to their own residents. And I want to iterate once again that this is not a national public building, as it has been suggested. And during this time, since the meeting of the identified experts, there has been no change that has had any substance that has been submitted to Bill for recommendation. In fact, the contrary. The Friends of Two Lights have not followed the spirit of the meeting, of the public meeting that we have had. They have never once came up to Bill and sat down with him as a group and made any constructive suggestions to him. And I think that it is unreasonable to submit any kind of a proposal, particularly in Bill's absence, to make any changes that is, without any doubt, geared specifically to what he is doing. And you can throw in other historic structures like Fort Williams and whatever other historic structures that we have here in the town of Cape Lisbon. But the essence of this whole process is directed at his home. Approximately a year ago, there is a process in this town. We have a planning board. And the issue of an ordinance regarding historic structures was discussed at length. My understanding, I have nothing to back it up, but my understanding is that the planning board had approximately 20 meetings. I know that there were at least two public meetings because I attended them. And the ordinance as it exists today was discussed over and over again. Many people that live near historic structures, many people that, like my son that owns them, and several others that had a concern regarding historic structures, spoke. The very issue of a 45-day waiting period was discussed at length. And again, very specifically, and in the final analysis, the town council adopted the ordinance as it exists today. If there are citizens in this community that are not happy with it, and I can appreciate that, But if there are citizens that are not happy with that ordinance or any other ordinance, they should go through the process that exists, one that the public can get involved in, one that the public can provide their input, and certainly the relative committees within the town council could give this some thought. They're the experts at it. And to take an ordinance that took a considerable amount of time and several meetings and totally overturn it or put it to one side so we can revisit this issue once again for the sole purpose of preventing an individual to do something to his private residence, I just think is very, very unreasonable. Thank you for your time. And I'll entertain any questions that any of the council have. Yes,
Councilor.
Councilor Chairman Beyer, I just wanted to let Mr. Krakus know that Zoning Ordinance Rewrite Committee included town council members, planning board members, zoning board members, Conservation Commission members, and did meet at least 20 times. And this was part of the complete rewrite of every ordinance we have in town. So the town council was part of that as well.
Well, thank you. I was unaware of just who, other than the planning board, that might have been involved. I got involved on two public meetings and two public meetings only. And I don't recall now whether those meetings were chaired either by the town council or the planning board. But I'm sure there were many knowledgeable individuals about the history of this town and the problems that the then existing ordinances had and the changes that needed to be made and why they needed to be made. And this was not treated lightly, I'm sure, as you have indicated. Any other questions that someone would like to ask me, I'd be very pleased to answer.
I'd like to know why Mr. Krakus didn't know until this afternoon that this was an item we would be discussing tonight, since clearly his son is out of state and needed representation.
My son called me late this afternoon. He had just found out about it.
My question is, why did Mr. Krakus, the owner, only find out today?
He found out about it by the... I believe he had a discussion with the previous speaker this afternoon. He had made several attempts to contact him. None of his calls were returned until mid-afternoon. I believe it was at that conversation that Bill was notified that this subject was going to be discussed here this evening. And I had a conversation with him earlier in the day. During that conversation, he did not indicate anything to me about a meeting about this subject. He told me there was going to be a meeting tonight, but whether or not this was going to be on the agenda, whether or not any members of the Friends of Two Lights were going to be here to discuss anything, and my response at that time, out of curiosity, I said, I think I will come. Later on in the afternoon, it was probably closer to 4 o'clock, he called me and he told me he had just learned that this subject was going to specifically be discussed here this evening. Now, certainly he couldn't be running back down here again. He made one special trip back here a couple weeks ago to meet with the... those that were identified at the town council workshop, specifically to meet with them. And after being absent from his office for approximately 1 month, it was very difficult really for him to come racing back here this afternoon in order to attend this meeting.
Thank you.
Any other questions for Mr. Parks?
Thank you very much for your attention.
Anybody else wish to speak?
If I may, just for a second, I would like to rebut something that was said because it creates a mistaken impression, I do believe. On Friday, Mr. Krakus and I had a conversation at which time we were planning to get together this weekend. And he called me Saturday morning, I believe, when I was out. I called him Saturday night, he was out. I called, he called me Saturday night, I was out. I called him Sunday morning, he was out. He called me Sunday afternoon, I was out. I called him Sunday night, he was gone. When I did have a conversation with him today, I said that we had learned that this meeting last week, that this meeting was the last meeting before his 45-day period was up, and that we were going to be presenting the petitions because we felt we had no other time to present them. And that's the extent of that issue. There was absolutely no effort whatsoever to attempt to submarine anybody, and I resent the implication.
Does anyone else want to speak before we move on? Yes, please, say who you are and also be succinct.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. My name is Paul McDonald. I live at 4 Lighthouse Point Road in Cape Elizabeth. I just want to clear up another misperception and then make one brief point. The misperception concerns the failure of any of the members of the Friends of Two Lights to attend the meeting with Mr. Beyer and the members of the historic preservation groups. We were invited to attend that meeting, but the unilateral condition that was imposed by Mr. Caracas on our attendance at that meeting was that, number one, we would not speak to the press at all about the substance of that meeting, and number two, that we must agree never again to speak to the press about the issue of the Two Lights Keeper's House and efforts to preserve it. And that was a condition that we could not and would not live with, and that's the reason why no representative from our group attended that meeting. The second point that I want to make is that while it is true that Mr. Caracas has offered time and offered to meet with whatever interested groups there are to discuss the issue, and I'll put the word discuss in quotes, the discussion has consisted thus far of an explanation of what he is going to do. There has been no dialogue, no back and forth, and no suggestions taken from anyone as to what can be done to improve the proposed plans, and more importantly, what consideration, if any, will be given to the concerns of the historic preservationists. So while there has been a great deal of time spent and meetings had between Mr. Caracas and various other people, it hasn't been in an attempt to change his plans, but rather an attempt to convince those who are willing to go up to his house that he's right and we're wrong. And we continue to believe that the Lighthouse Keeper's House at Two Lights is an historic structure that deserves to be preserved and deserves consideration and application of the standards that have been adopted by the Secretary of the Interior and the standards that are the most widespread and widely applied standards in the field of historic preservation throughout the United States and the state of Maine. Thank you very much.
Hey, before you go, I'm sorry, there's a question. Councilor Reed?
Yes, I'd like to ask Mr. McDonald if he notified the television press of this meeting and what was going to be on it that wasn't on the agenda.
I notified the press that there was going to be a meeting this evening, and I advised them of our plans to present to you the very things that were presented here. Number one, that we had obtained a legal opinion from a reputable Portland, Maine law firm that indeed supported our position that this council has both the right and the power to act to preserve the Lighthouse Keeper's House at Two Lights. Number two, I informed the press that we had indeed circulated a petition and obtained a substantial number of signatures from residents of Cape Elizabeth who support the efforts of the Friends of Two Lights. And number three, I informed the press that while we had made our attempts to get historic preservationists, and in particular, Earl Shuttleworth and the Maine Historic Preservation Commission, to voice their opinion as to whether or not the proposed plans for the Keeper's House are in keeping with historic preservation standards, that Mr. Shuttleworth and the Commission would not act until requested to do so by this Council
And so I informed the press that indeed we were going to make that request of the council. That's what I told them.
And the other point of clarification for the general public, the Friends of Two Lights hired an attorney to seek an opinion to present to the town council.
That is correct.
Thank you.
Yes, Councilor Watson.
Mr. McDonald, a question I have is that my understanding is that Mr. Caracas had a mock-up plan of his house as it would be, as it could be modified to meet the Department of the Interior standards to be reviewed. Have any of you, the Friends of Two Lights, reviewed that mock-up, and have you talked with him about your view of that versus what he's trying to do?
I went up to his house about a week to 10 days before the emergency town council meeting that I believe was held on August 16th. I did see a mock-up. I'm not conversant with architectural parlance, but there was a very detailed model. And he did take a lot of time to explain what he intends to do and made use of that model. I'm not sure what you are referring to in terms of a depiction of what the house would look like if it conformed to the standards. But again, I'd love to go up there and take a look at what he's doing. But I was not going to do that at the expense of not being able to allow the press and the public to be aware of what's going on here.
One thing I just wanted to interject is, I think at the town council workshop that we discussed that we thought these issues would be better addressed without the press. I think that our minutes might reflect that between the various parties.
Well, I don't recall that. I certainly know that I never agreed to it.
Other questions for Mr. McDonald? Okay, thank you, Mr. McDonald.
Thank you.
Yes, anyone else want to speak? Step right up. Please give your name, where you live.
My name is Hillary Egan, and I live on Hannaford Cove Road. And I have a few comments that I wanted to make as related to being a petitioner. I was one of the people that collected the more than 700 names. And the most frequent comment that people made when I talked about, when we read together, the language on the top of the petition was, I thought Cape Elizabeth already had an historic preservation ordinance. And I explained that my understanding was that the only ordinance that fell under that category was that you had to notify the town 45 days before demolition or alteration. And one, a very savvy woman said, but that's not preservation. Secondly, it's a lot of requests have been made of Friends of Two Lights to step up to the plate, review Mr. Caracas's plans, and become historic preservation experts. There's not a historic preservation expert, self-appointed or otherwise qualified, in the group. We simply know in our hearts and in our minds that this is a historically significant building. And what's being asked is that the town come up with a group of citizens and experts that will discuss together and build an ordinance that protects historically significant buildings in our town that can be identified by, in fact, that group of citizens. You don't need to be an expert to understand that that particular structure is clearly historically significant enough to be protected. Thirdly, I have had one conversation with Mr. Caracas of probably 20 minutes in length last Thursday or Friday in the morning. And although we talked about his alternate plans from the Secretary of Interior, and he said, of course, that he knew about the set of standards, and he had asked his architect to present him with this alternate plan, and he said that even the Friends of Two Lights wouldn't be happy with that plan because it did much worse things architecturally to the house than the plans that he's proposed. And although Mr. Caracas and I differ individually with what we would do with the Two Lights Keeper's Cottage, if I had that opportunity, we came to a very strong agreement that it would be much easier for the owner to come up with a successful plan if the town of Cape Elizabeth had a set of standards that he could aim for. Right now, it's a great burden to the private property owner to shoot in the dark trying to appease historic preservation citizens, town council people, people who may like lighthouses a lot and collect postcards, but he doesn't have any real set of standards that he can give to his architect and say, let's try to meet all 8 or all 20 of these and get to where we want to go. Finally, if Mr. Karakas's now proposed plans, and maybe there's a different set that I haven't seen, the town hasn't seen, if they're so completely consistent with historic preservation, then the committee of experts that we hope the town will pull together to create the ordinance won't have any problem with his proposed alterations. But to rely on a process where there is no historic experts involved, I think you're short-sighted on the part of the town. Thank you.
Thank you. Is there any other member of the public? Yes, Mr. Karakas.
Yes, I'd like to just reiterate one thing. The Friends of Two Lights have had ample opportunity to go up to Bill's house and to review the plans as they now exist on what he's going to do to that property. And as recently as a week ago last Friday, when identified experts did in fact go up there, no one from the Friends of Two Lights chose to go along with them. To hear the comments and ask questions of anybody from the Friends of Two Lights, they use as an excuse that they did not go up there because the press could not be invited. When the town council scheduled a public hearing approximately a month ago, and their workshop shortly thereafter, there was a process that was put in place, and I know you're all aware of it, but I have to emphasize this. Mr. McDonald was specifically asked on several occasions not to play this thing out through the press. That's not to mean that the press should be excluded, but you should not try to alter the ordinances of the town of Cape Elizabeth through the media. This is the place to do it, right here. And the press is obviously very welcome. But when you're going to be using the press for your own personal gains and you refuse to go through the process, that's a very unreasonable way to approach anything. And they have not looked at plans, any of the recent plans. They have refused to go up there. Sure, they went up there a month and a half ago. Well, I'll tell you something. I'd like to have a dollar for every set of plans that have been designed on that house in the last 9 months. They changed dramatically and frequently. And to deviate from a process that was established here by the public and by the town council, unanimously they voted twice to proceed on a certain path. Bill has tried to do that. He has lived up to it. He's been open and above board with everybody. He has not refused to answer questions, to show anything to anybody. What has happened is that the people, the Friends of Two Lights, have not followed that process. They have as much as said that our objective is to stop you. Thank you.
Thank you. Has everyone spoken, or is that someone coming up? Someone coming up. Would you please say who you are?
My name is Florence Braff, and I live on Hannaford Cove Road. I wanted the council to turn back to the proper process, which is the process that we used when we gathered petitions. The First Amendment is the most valuable thing, I think, and I value the petition process enormously. I was upset to hear that we hadn't followed the proper process. I spent some hours talking to people around town, asking them if they would like to support an historic conservation ordinance, and that's the petition that's before you tonight. I hate to see the whole conversation get diverted into the ins and outs of one particular argument, because that's not what's important in this town. I'm sorry, I'm nervous. That's what you hear. The sense of sadness I was aware of when I gathered petitions, pardon me, the sense of loss, there was a feeling around town that nothing could be done about the keeper's cottage, that it's possible that that would be Cape Elizabeth's Union Station, and maybe that will be so. But in fact, there is a legal right in this council to do something about it. And there is a sense in many people that something should be done about it. But in any event, that we badly need an ordinance. People were grieving over their grandfather's house, a number of people who live in historic structures whom you will recognize, you will find their names on the petition, because that's the important issue. Not one house, one person, and arguments about who said what to whom. I think that is a really sad thing to see if this meeting focuses on that. And I urge you most sincerely to do what you can to prevent demolition and loss of a very valuable town. It's a town treasure, that building. But what we really need is to do something to protect our history, because we lose it every day that we let go by. Thank you for hearing me.
Thank you. Now, yes. Also, please indicate your name and where you live.
Yes. John Rich, Hannaford Cove. I'm one of the members of the Friends of Two Lights. And I'm sad to see this coming down to personalities, because as far as I'm concerned and as far as the other members of the Friends of Two Lights, there is nothing personal about this. We are dealing with a structure that we all love, that we feel is vital to the history and the future of Cape Elizabeth, the state of Maine, and, as you know, to the United States. We're fighting to try to keep, to prevent changes, certainly major changes as we've seen them, to this very wonderful building, the Keeper's House. So it's not a personal matter, and I don't think we should approach it that way. Also, I think you've seen, we're not the only ones, this group that you see here tonight, who feel this way. You see this tremendous number of petitions that we got just by standing on the corner for a very short time, and probably 4 or 5 to 1, the feeling in Cape Elizabeth that that structure should be saved. Now, I would like to see us do some original, some thoughtful thinking about this thing. There are many other ways we can approach it. There are many other ways. Perhaps now we can talk to Mr. Caracas in different ways. We've come up with some thoughts ourselves, which we're not quite ready to put out, that may be a way to work around this, something that would be acceptable to Mr. Caracas. But we do need time. And the responsibility for what we're going through today is the responsibility of former councils, town councils of Cape Elizabeth. They created the problem by not passing proper ordinances. It is up to you people who are now sitting in those seats to try to do something to correct it, and if you don't, we'll all be the losers. Thank you.
Okay, I think we must have heard from everyone in the room twice. So before we get to three times, I'm going to assume that at this point we're ready to end the unusual aspect of having people speak, and instead remind the council that we have before us on the agenda and on the table consideration of establishment of historic preservation study committee. That is the item before us. Councilor Berry.
Mr. Chairman, would it be appropriate to get this thing off the dime, so to speak, and up dead center and move it ahead? If I move to suspend the rules to consider the proposed ordinance that Mr. Aiken has presented to us tonight.
And was that a question or was that a motion?
I'll make the motion just to keep things.
Thank you. It's moved. Is there a second?
Second.
Seconded by Councilor Fritz.
Let me remind everyone that I believe as an item is out of order under this, we need to have affirmative of 5 votes in order to move to the issue. Is there any discussion on this before we vote?
What does the ordinance look like? Have we been provided a copy of the...
Debatable? This motion is suspended.
Hold on a second while we debate how we're supposed to do this the right way.
I think so.
Okay, well, while you're checking that, John had a perfectly good question, which was for more clarification of, I think at the moment, Henry's motion is solely that we take something out of order, and the specificity of it is to come next if there's a positive vote. Is that correct?
Yes, yes.
Yes, I think that is correct.
Yes.
Okay, other discussion? Okay, then, let me suggest, because this seems to be taking a great deal of time, that we do 2 things. Let's reiterate the question, and we'll do a roll call vote. Before that, yes, Councilor Reed, did you have a question or comment?
I was just thinking, while time is ticking away, if we could vote on the item number 46, which is consideration of the establishment of the Historic Preservation Study Committee, and at least have that.
Let's take the issue out of order, and then complete that, and then we can get to... to the basic one. Okay, so let me make sure that before we do a roll call vote, a yes vote supports taking it out of order, a nay vote says that we will not take up the issue. Is that what everyone thinks? Okay, let us then vote, please.
Councilor Barry?
Yes.
Councilor Fritz?
Yes.
Councilor Graf?
No.
Councilor McGinty?
No.
Councilor Reed?
No.
Councilor Watson?
No.
Chairman Beyer?
No. Okay, that motion fails. We are now back at the table with the original presentation on the agenda and on the table, the consideration to establish a Historic Preservation Study Committee. Would anyone like to make, yes, Councilor Graf.
Mr. Chairman, I would make a motion that we approve the Historic Preservation Study Committee, as set forth in the charge that was previously read by the chairman, which has been designated as item 47.
Second the motion.
Moved and seconded. Discussion? Yes, Councilor McGinty.
I'd like to amend the motion to add that we request from Mr. Shuttleworth an opinion, his opinion, on the issue at hand. And also that we consider getting a town attorney opinion on our legal standing on this.
Don't we already have one?
If you're asking me if I accept the motion, I don't, in the sense that I think this is a motion to set up a study committee. I've never seen a study committee set up with one of the provisions to be have an attorney opinion on a property that might be resolved or might not be resolved before this committee is even appointed. I want to, if obviously you can make that motion as an amendment, it can be voted on separately, but I do not believe that it's part of a study committee draft. I think it's a separate issue.
Okay, I'll withdraw my motion as part of the study committee draft, but I would like to propose that perhaps after we establish this committee.
I have no problem with that. If it's an item not on the agenda, if there's 5 votes, and it can be done. My only motion was the item that is on the agenda, and that's item 47.
Okay, let's stick with that. That's moved and seconded by Councilor Barry.
It's
other 40, discussion?
46.
It's the one on the Historic Preservation Committee.
47.
47 online.
Well, there's a couple different numbers floating around.
Okay. It's item 46, but item 47 on the actual draft proposal.
Yep.
Mr. McGovern.
Other discussion? Councilor Fritz.
I'm concerned about the, this proposes that a report to the town council come no later than June 30th of 99. So that's 9 months. That doesn't seem like all that long a time to
review ordinances from other places, to update the current historical list, to set priorities and the whole task that's involved, and then make some recommendations, and also get the kind of public input and feedback that is required of this. It seems like it should take at least a year.
We have had other committees that have asked for extended time, I think, if they found that they didn't have enough time to do it properly.
Right, but 9 months still seems to be setting it up quite a short period of time.
Mr. Chairman?
Yes, Councilor Goff.
I think the issue in our workshop was that there was a significant number of council members that thought this was so important that they did not want this to languish, and that was the reason for the relatively short date.
Right.
I'm confident that if this committee is working diligently and came back before the town council, such as our committee on aerial towers, that wanted more time, that would certainly probably have a fine reception. But I, as most councilors, thought it was important to set some sense of urgency, and if you start establishing a committee that's not reporting back for more than a year, you could lose that. So I think that was the discussion at the workshop, and that's why we came out with 9 months. But you know, if it has to be extended, then that committee can come before the town council.
I'd like to move the question.
Move the question? Okay. Let's prepare, review in my mind the vote. Positive supports establishing the committee as it was read earlier, quite a bit earlier, by Councilor Groff. Ready to vote. All those in favor, please say, raise your hand. Any against it? It passed unanimously. Okay.
Councilor Byer, could we take a short 5-minute break?
3-minute break?
3 minutes, good.
3-minute break. Okay.
Thank you.
Item number, I believe, 47, appointments to Town Farm Ordinance and Easement Drafting Committee. Councilor Reed.
Yes, thank you. As the appointment chair, I can say that we've never had more opportunity to involve more citizens on so many committees in all the years I've done this. And I continually thank the members of the public who come forward and serve on these committees. Before us tonight is the Town Farm Ordinance and Easement Drafting Committee, and I'm happy to report that the town councilors who are willing to serve are Councilors Watson and Fritz, Tom Emery from the Planning Board, Richard Berman from the Land Trust, John Green from the Conservation Commission, and John Chapman and Ann Wacker as citizens. And I would ask that the Town Council approved that list.
So moved.
Yes.
So moved. Second?
Second.
Second by Councilor Berry. Any discussion? Hearing none, all those in favor? Oh, I'm sorry.
I just want to make a quick comment, the ditto again, and Rosemary says this often, but we don't maybe say it enough, that we do get outstanding people to come and serve on these committees and do a great job. I just want to reiterate that.
Okay, all those in favor, raise your hand, please. It passes 7-0. Thank you. Our next item, appointments to Registration Appeals Board. Councilor Reed. Oh, I'm sorry, the town clerk.
Thank you very much. Currently, the state statute requires all municipalities to have a Registration Appeals Board. We'd recommend John Walker, John Doyen to serve, and alternates Ann Schenck and Bob Bayross. These individuals have been approved by the local political parties to serve until September, or they recommend to serve until September 29th, 2001.
Thank you. Is there a motion?
So moved.
Moved by Councilor Fritz.
Second.
Seconded by Councilor Reed. Any discussion? Hearing none, all those in favor, please signify. All it's a vote, 7-0 in favor. Thank you very much. Moving to the next item, to set a public hearing on pool referendum for October 14th, 98. That you also, Debbie?
Yes, thank you. This is simply following up on the town attorney's advice for the pool referendum to hold a public hearing at our next council meeting Wednesday, October 14th. Although there would not be a formal council action, this is simply an opportunity for the public to speak regarding the referendum that the community will be voting on at the November 3rd election.
Good, thank you. One requires a vote.
You're going to bring up the date.
Yeah, Mr. Byer. Yeah. Chairman Byer. There's been some suggestion. It's customary on when there's a Monday holiday that the council meets on Wednesday. there was some discussion because of this holiday not being a major holiday that might, the council may wish to meet on that Monday. So.
Yes, Councilor Reed?
That was also to facilitate the fact that certain councilors hadn't planned that the meeting would be Wednesday that week.
That's right. We don't usually go into councilors' schedules, but yes, there was at least one councilor who had scheduled something later in the week.
So the Monday and the date is?
The 12th.
The 12th. Is that comfortable with everyone for a meeting date?
At great personal sacrifice, I'll give up my trip to Quebec.
Okay, well, thank you. Then I guess.
Thank you, Henry.
It is set for the 12th. Okay, thank you. We're also now still back on the public. I'm sorry, which are we on here? The public hearing on the pool, right?
Mm-hmm.
Okay, was there a motion on that?
So moved for the 12th.
Seconded by Councilor Berry. Thank you. Further discussion? Hearing none, all those in favor, please raise your hand.
So the meeting's the 12th of October?
Yes.
All right, thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Okay, thank you. And we now have completed that, and I will take the liberty, if I may, just to say that having served on the pool committee, and with a very, very capable and diligent group of people who spent a great deal of time, I'd like to encourage everyone to support that. I am absolutely convinced that the group came up with a recommendation that gives the town a lot of bang for the buck, and I think that's very important, and I applaud that committee for doing that. Forgive my soliloquy. Yes, Councilor Reed.
Well, I just wanted to let you know that having served on the committee that recommended your committee be formed, that I will also support the pool referendum, and also let you know that the talented people on the committee that preceded yours also recognized early on that there was major work that needed to be done to keep that major asset of this community going. Thank you.
Thank you.
Mr. Chairman.
Yes.
As Councilor McGinty had brought up earlier, I would very much like to hear from the Maine Historic Preservation Commission on their opinion of the Caracas proposals to the Two Lights Keeper's House. Since they are the state's preservation of historic properties, the expert for the state, I think that since they did go to the meeting, it would be very valuable for us to have an opinion from them.
If that's in the form of a motion, it needs a second, and it would still, I think, be something off the normal agenda and then require 5 votes to approve it. Were you making a motion?
Be off the agenda and then?
Well, to take something that's off the agenda. It's not on the agenda as a subject. I believe that's correct.
To take up an item out of order requires suspension of the rules. That requires 5 votes.
I would like to move that.
Fine. Is there a second?
Make a formal request.
Yep, thank you. Is there a second? Hearing none, I believe it dies. But thank you for bringing it up. Okay, moving then to citizens' discussion of items not on the agenda. We've really already done that.
I just had one quick item, just to remind the town council and any interested members of the public, is that the town council has a workshop on this Wednesday night to go over the facilities 2000 progress report, particularly the master plan for the Levitt property. And in addition, the council approved some goals this evening, and I had a discussion with Chairman Beyer earlier today that would be a good opportunity following the workshop facilities 2000 for the councilors to look at those goals and decide which councilors will be the lead councilors on those goals. There's also a paper that was before you this evening that you should bring Wednesday evening relating to one of the goals involving student involvement with town government and with the town council in particular.
Good, thank you. Any other items to come up? Is there a motion to adjourn?
I will make a motion to adjourn with the thanks of the people of Cape Elizabeth and the town councilors, Bill, for your outstanding service.
I would second the motion and the remark.
It's seconded by Councilor Berry. Thank you very much. All those in favor? Thank you. Okay, we're adjourned. Thank you all very much.